Hello and welcome to NewsClick. I'm Sumedha. On this episode of the Daily Roundup, we give you a glimpse of some of the most important stories from India and around the world. Take a look at our top stories today. Our top story of the day is straight out from Karnataka, where we're focusing on the Sadhvi Pragya area, which falls in the Devanagari district. The state is all set to go to polls on the 23rd of April. However, a huge instance has come out to our attention today, where a 17-year-old Dalit boy was attacked by upper caste men in Karnataka. He was not even attacked once, but thrice for swimming in a river which was supposedly to be used by upper caste men. Not just this, following this, a mob of about 200 men targeted multiple Dalit households, and children and women were beaten up brutally and ruthlessly by the upper caste men. A child who was as young as 6 years old was also beaten up by a bicycle chain. The anti-caste activist and poet Huchangi Prasad was also attacked when he tried to mediate with the upper caste Upara men. And he had to also be hospitalized with head and back injuries. He also suffered pain in his kidney area and his finger was also fractured. The instance actually happened on the 12th of April, which is just 2 days before the celebrations of the Ambedkar Jayanti and 10 days to go for the polls in the state. So this instance has come out and Prasad was also attacked in 2011 earlier by right-wing goons for daring to write about caste. He was then threatened that if he uses the anti-Hindu rhetoric, he will be attacked again, and he was warned by upper caste men that his fingers would be broken. And in 2019, now, his fingers have been fractured for daring to plan celebrations for the Ambedkar Jayanti and for taking on upper caste men. So at NewsClick, we had previously had the fortune of speaking to Huchangi Prasad earlier on the issues of caste violence in Karnataka and a lot more. Have a look at this conversation.
Vandu anishtavada mattu neechatanadinda hindutvadinda tumkondirthakantaha paddhati hindu dharmadalli ದೇವದಾಸಿಯನ್ನು ಇವತ್ತೇನಾದರೂ ಜೀವಂತವಾಗಿದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಕಾರಣ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅದು ಹಿಂದೂ ಧರ್ಮ. ಬ್ರಾಹ್ಮಣಿಸಮ್, ದಲಿತ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರು ಮಾತ್ರ ದೇವದಾಸಿಯರಾಗಬೇಕು, ಮದುವೆ ಆಗಂಗಿಲ್ಲ, ಚಿಕ್ಕ ಬಾಲಕಿಯರಿಗೆ ಮ್ಯಾರೆ ಪೂಜಾರಿ ತಾಳಿ ಕಟ್ಟೋದು, ಅವಳ ಲೈಫ್ ಪೂರ್ತಿ ಬರೀ ಭಿಕ್ಷೆ ಬೆಗ್ಗಿಂಗ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂತ, ಸೆಕ್ಸ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂತ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಅನೇಕ ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂತ ಆಕೆ ಬದುಕಬೇಕು. ಆಕೆಯ ಸಾವು ಸಹ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ನಿಕೃಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ, ಒಂದು ಮಹಾಮಾರಿ ಮಾರಣಾಂತಿಕ ಕಾಯಿಲೆಗಳಿಂದ ದೇವದಾಸಿಯವರು ಇವತ್ತು ಸಾಯ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಿ, ಮಹಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ದೇವದಾಸಿ ಪದ್ಧತಿ ಕದ್ದು ಮುಚ್ಚಿ ನಡೀತಾ ಇದೆ. ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಮಾತ್ರ ನಿರ್ಮೂಲನೆಯಾಗಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಜನರಿಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಖಂಡಿತ ದೇವದಾಸಿಯರು ಇವತ್ತಿಗೂ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಇನ್ನೂ ಹಾಕ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ದೇವದಾಸಿ ಮಕ್ಕಳನ್ನು ಸಮಾಜ ಒಪ್ಕೊಂತೇನೆ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಅವರಿಗೆ ಹೆಣ್ಣು ಕೊಡೋದಾಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಮದುವೆ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಏ ದೇವದಾಸಿ ಯಾಕೊಬ್ಬ ವೇಷೆ, ಅವ್ರ ಮಗಳನ್ನ ತಂದ್ಕೋಬೇಕಾ ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಕೆಟ್ಟ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ. ದೇವದಾಸಿಯರಿಗೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರದಿಂದ ಬರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳಿಲ್ಲ, ಆ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳಿಂದ ಕಡಿತ. ₹1,000 ಪಿಂಚಣಿ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ತಿಂಗಳಿಗೆ ₹1,000 ಏನಕ್ಕೂ ಸಾಧ್ಯವಿಲ್ಲ.
Moving on, we're going on to our second very important story, which is straight from Kashmir. Kashmir is going to polls tomorrow, and now we want to show you an exclusive ground report by Bhasha Singh called The Pulse of the Nation. Living true to its name, she talks to multiple people from different backgrounds to understand what are the Kashmiris wanting in this election, what are their issues, what are their aspirations. Take a look at our ground report.
तो ये 5 साल हैं, वो तो मुझे नहीं लगता है कुछ किया है. बेटर तो बात की बात है, लेकिन जो हो रहा था फिर भी थोड़ा स्मूथ चल रहा था, उससे भी बदतर हालात हो गए कश्मीर के.
सही कि अभी कश्मीर के जो हालात हैं पिछले 4-5 साल में काफ़ी ख़राब हुए, काफ़ी पैलेट्स चले, तो उससे कितना फ़र्क पड़ा कश्मीर पर?
बहुत बहुत, यहाँ बहुत लोग भी हालात से पीछे ही हुआ, आगे नहीं हुआ. यहाँ रोज हड़ताल, रोज कर्फ्यू, पत्थरबाजी, परेशानी हो जाता, गरीब आवाम को परेशानी होता है.
बस मुद्दा ये तो हम यहाँ मतलब ये मेन हॉल का काम मिलता है हमको, वो हम कम करता है, वो हमारा बाप भी करता है, हम भी करता है, हमारा बच्चे भी करता है ये काम। हम गरीब आदमी, इसके बगैर और हम हमारे पास कोई काम नहीं है।
हम मोदी जी को इतला कर रहा है कि हमारा रोज़गार का चारा कीजिए, और गवर्नमेंट से हम अपील कर रहा है कि हम इस बदबू काम से हमको बचाइए। देखो हमको, हमको पास छोटे छोटे बच्चे हैं, हमको बहुत आदमी मर चुका है।
अभी तो MP का है, दिल्ली का चुनाव
हाँ है, तो मगर फायदा क्या है? अगर घर घर में जाएंगे, जैसे बाहर लोगों में जाते हैं घर घर, बोलते हैं क्या क्या तुमको तंगी है, तुम बोलो, हम हमारा वोट हमको दे दो, वोट हमारे को डालना। यहाँ नहीं वो आते हैं, ऐसे यहाँ पे नहीं चलता है, यहाँ डालते हैं। हम किसी के पास दरखास्त लेकर जाते हैं, इस काम के लिए हमको पैसा दे दो, हमको बाथरूम है, लेटरिंग है, इसके लिए भी पैसा नहीं दिया।
On the Daily Roundup, we've extensively covered the issues of the election violence. We'd previously reported how on the 11th of April, in the first phase of the elections in Tripura, multiple instances of violence and booth capturing had come out. In connection with this, the CPIM had led multiple protests in the state as well as in Delhi, and had also submitted a memorandum to the Election Commission to ensure that the second phase of election is more safe and no violence is witnessed in the second phase of the election. Following the multiple pressures from the CPIM and the demands on the ground, the Election Commission has gone on to state that polls in Tripura for the second phase will be postponed to the 23rd of April instead of being conducted on the 18th of April. Similarly, the President Ramnath Kovind has also given a nod to cancel elections in Vellore following multiple cash seizures which had happened in the month of March. Cash as much as 200 crores was seized in the month of March, and following this, elections in Vellore also stand cancelled. We will keep following updates on more stories relating to election violence and the change in the dates of the polls as well. Moving ahead, another big story that had gained attention yesterday was the story of the IT raids on the house of K. Kanimozhi. Following the raids, nothing has currently been found, but what is important in the story is to remember that this is not the first IT raid. In fact, it was the 12th IT raid that had happened in this election season. It is also important to remember that the Election Commission had warned the IT department to ensure that the raids were taking place in a neutral manner, and also that the Commission was informed of such raids. Moving ahead to another big story, which is of Sadhvi Pragya Thakur. She has actually gone ahead to announce that she will be contesting elections from Madhya Pradesh, from the Bhopal area, against Congress's Digvijay Singh. It is important to remember that she is the same woman who was accused in the 2008 Maligaon case. Allegedly, her motorcycle was used in the blast, and it has also been said by multiple activists and legal experts that allegedly members of the BJP tried to sabotage the case, and members who are affiliated to the Sanatan Sanstha were also allegedly involved in the case. Now we're moving on to the international section, where we're following up on the arrest of Ola Bini. And speaking on this, we have Prashant with Kiran Chandra, who is the General Secretary of the Free Software Movement of India. Take a look at that discussion.
Kiran, to start with, could you talk a bit about why various tech organizations across the world have joined together in this campaign to free Ola Bini?
See, the arrest of Ola Bini has been very sensitive to all the privacy lovers of the world and also the technologists. The way that he has been portrayed in certain sections of the European media is something that is really worrisome, and it is unprecedented for him. He has been portrayed as someone with some criminal motives, and it is very unfortunate. If you look at who Ola Bini has been, is an important question that the society beyond the tech community needs to really look at. Ola Bini has been a developer for more than 1.5 decades, and he has been contributing significantly to the society. In the last 1 year itself, if we were to really quantify and look at the magnitude of the work that he has done for the global common good, in the last 1 year itself, he has committed close to 1,200 times to the different free software repositories that are publicly available. It comes down, if you assume that Ola was working for 10 hours a day, and he was contributing in 1 year, for every 3 hours, he has been contributing code to the society. You have just blocked him, put him behind the bars, and the way in which he has been portrayed is really worrisome. What did Olabini do is the question that is pondering us. His contribution was very significant in the dimensions of privacy enhancement technologies, in the area of free software development, and also in the lines of multidisciplinary subjects that include drug discovery. And I think the way in which he's been criminalized, the way in which a techie programmer who is a Swedish national living in Ecuador with valid work permits, and he has made Ecuador his home for the last few years. All the developers of the world were having a different perception about Ecuador. And now Ecuador illegally detains him in violation of all international laws, did not allow him to speak to his lawyers, detains him for 30 hours, and then produces him in front of the judge. That too very late in the night. And he, even in the absence of any interpreter, he is forced to speak with the judge. And all these are serious issues of concern. And he has been taken into preventive custody. He has been put into detained as a cause of prevention. I think with all valid permits, who has been doing it, and the way in which he has been criminalized, he has been picked up from the flight as if that he was fleeing the country. If you look at Olabini's blogs, or if you look at Olabini's tweets, we all very well understand that he is a martial arts passionate person. And he announced much in advance that he was leaving for Japan to pursue his martial arts events. And I think the way in which he has been pursued, he has been called as a Russian while he's a Swedish national. The Swedish embassy has not been communicated until his parents have been approaching this Swedish government. And the Swedish Ministry of Foreign Affairs needs to protect its own citizen. The way in which they're attributing Olabini makes us feel that being a good programmer and working for the society is a crime. And I think this is precisely the reason why the whole global tech communities are organizing ourselves for the release of Olabini. He's one amongst us. We are one amongst him. And this is going to be one for all for one among the developer fraternity.
That's all that we have for you today on this episode of the Daily Roundup. To follow these stories and many more, log on to our website www.newsclick.in, go to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook. Thank you for watching.